Michael Oren is Israel's ambassador to the United States and joins me now. Well, this is a very tough crisis all around. Benjamin Netanyahu was supposed to be here at the prime minister meeting at the White House today. Of course, he had to go back because of the crisis. Mm-hmm. What do you say to those, including President Sarkozy of France and Turkish denunciation from the foreign minister here, that who say that there was excessive force used? And there's an article in Haaretz today from Israeli commentators saying that the Israeli Defense Force used too much force in using, you know, live ammunition against these protesters.
Well, I don't know what too much force is, Andrea, to protect one's life. I have a son serving in a special forces unit in Israel, in the Israeli Foreign Forces, and I would like him to use any force necessary to save himself. The Israeli commandos that landed on the board, on the deck of this ship, landed with paint guns. They landed with paint guns, the most non-lethal form of weapon you can imagine. They had sidearms to protect themselves in case they were attacked. They were attacked with knives, they were attacked with iron bars, and they were attacked with weapons. We have several shot soldiers who were shot. I don't know what kind of force you'd have to use to protect yourself, but I'm sure that these soldiers understood that and they did what they had to do.
Why are Israeli commentators today questioning whether or not this was in response? Let's just posit that this was a provocation, that you knew the flotilla was coming. Why doesn't their training demand that they not use live guns against a flotilla who say that they're bringing in aid? And then I also want to ask, obviously, the more basic question is why stop the flotilla at all?
Okay, we have to go back several steps. All right, this flotilla is bound for Gaza. Gaza is ruled by a sinister terrorist regime called Hamas, which by its covenant and by its deeds is sworn to destroy the state of Israel. They have fired over 7,000 rockets at our civilians. And under international law and by any rational criteria, Israel has a right to defend its citizens from that type of attack.
Martin Indyk, the former U.S. ambassador to Israel, someone well known to you, who participates, who leads the Saban Forum at the Brookings Institution, he has said that the United States, the U.S. administration now has to help Israel save itself by finding a way to deal with Hamas, to stop this embargo, this blockade, because this is alienating the rest of the world.
Well, if Martin Indyk, who I greatly respect, has ideas how to do that, we're always open to ideas. The reality is Hamas has sworn to destroy us. Hamas has tried.
They are the elected leaders.
They won an election, but they also overthrew violently the legitimate government of Gaza and killed hundreds of their fellow Palestinians in the process, including chucking them off the top of rooftops. So this is not a legitimate regime. And we have the right, and it's a right recognized under international law, it's a right upheld by the Egyptians, by the Obama administration, to defend ourselves.
Egypt has now opened the Rafah crossing. So you have Egypt now alienated by this. Egypt, who's been helping you keep, or at least claims to be helping Israel keep supplies that could help any terror groups inside Gaza. You've got Turkey alienated. Turkey, the one ally in the Muslim world who was negotiating and had joint military exercises with Israel, has now kicked out your ambassador, recalled their ambassador. What prospect does Israel have at this stage?
Well, Andrea, you've asked me so many questions. I'll have to go back and back and back. For Egypt has opened its border to certain humanitarian goods. Our border has been always open to humanitarian goods. We have 100 trucks going in every day to Gaza with food and medicine, and there's no shortage of food and medicine. If this flotilla had wanted to bring in humanitarian aid, they would have accepted our offer made repeatedly over the past few weeks to transfer their cargoes to Israel, and we would then have conveyed it to responsible people within Gaza. And we're willing to give that aid to responsible people, not to the Hamas regime that will use materials, particularly building materials, to build bunkers and not schools and not hospitals. As for our relations with Turkey, we're saddened by the turn they've taken under the present government. We used to have a very close relationship with Turkey again. But this is the Turkey that canceled its military operations with us well in advance of that. It canceled them last year. It canceled them again this year. This is a Turkish leadership that has embraced Ahmadinejad of Iran, a leadership that, again, has sworn to destroy the Jewish state. I'm saddened by this, but Israel, at the end of the day, has to make decisions to defend its citizens. That's what this country is about, what any country is about. And the United States, I'm certain, would act no differently. And U.S. Coast Guard soldiers, men and women, landing on a boat carrying dangerous materials into the United States would take whatever measures were necessary to defend themselves if they were attacked with guns, knives, and iron bars.
The White House, the Obama White House, is not jumping to Israel's defense here, as White Houses have in the past. The White House is asking for the results of the investigation, a noticeably cool response. This has all the makings of an issue which will exacerbate difficult relations. And just as peace talks were sort of stumbling towards getting underway.
We were cooperating and communicating very, very closely over the last 24, 48 hours during the length of this whole crisis. Prime Minister Netanyahu spoke with the president three times yesterday by phone, and we are working intensely closely together to address this difficult situation.
We will have much more on this and all of the context and the background from Israel. Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
Michael Oren.